Well, this is an Angie Book Club special. This is an ABC special. If you've seen Secret Millionaire, if you also watch Dragon's Den, then it'll be of no surprise to you to know that my guest is Hilary Devey. Hello, Hilary.
Hi.
Thank you for coming in.
It's my pleasure entirely.
An amazing book, an amazing account of a life of someone who admits humble beginnings.
Very humble.
Okay. Tell me about your childhood.
I guess it was only when I began writing the book that you actually think about your childhood, isn't it? It's I've never really thought about my childhood. I think I had a very nomadic childhood, mm-hmm. and a very unusual childhood, because when I think how children are today, you know, I remember taking myself a mile walk at 3 years of age off to nursery school and back again, which you just wouldn't do today. But those days, it was quite the norm.
What was your childhood, what was your relationship like with your mother?
My mum was my best friend. We fell in and out, like all mothers and daughters, but I adored her. I worshipped the ground she walked on. As she got older in life, she could be very volatile, but I loved her.
And your father?
I loved my dad, absolutely, totally. You know, I worshipped him. He died when I was quite young, and my mum died 3 years ago, and there isn't a day goes by that I really don't miss them both very much.
There's so many things I want to talk to you about in terms of building up your business, why you chose a haulage business as a female. I'd like to, if I may, tap on one area of your childhood that you recently opened up about when you were age 12. Mm. Are you quite happy to go there?
Yeah, no.
Okay.
No,
you, as I've read, you state that you were led by a friend at school into an area where a gentleman raped you.
Yes.
And you say he smelt of garlic.
Yes.
And had spotty skin. Mm. Are they the things that you remember about him? Have you blocked everything else out?
No, I hadn't really, and it was kind of because how it actually came that I wrote about it, because I literally had put it out of my head for decades, and I had to kind of, to write the book, describe each place I was living in, each pub that I lived in with my parents, and that's how I actually come to write about what happened to me in Accrington.
There's a part in the research that I did that says this book, most, when people write a book, they say, oh, it was like counselling, it was like therapy. I just was able, you know, the pen took over, and I now feel that it was a very therapeutic experience. But you don't say that at all, do you?
No, I don't feel it was cathartic or therapeutic in any way, shape or form. It was a very stressful time for me. And as I was kind of reading each bit, I was actually crying myself because it was bringing it back to me, exactly what I had been through, and think, could I go through those things again? And quite simply, I think the answer is no, I couldn't.
But those things have brought you to where you are now.
Yes.
And you're able to tell the story.
I think kind of our lives are a fait accompli, and somehow or other, God only throws at us what he believes we will handle.
Okay. Thank you for sharing that, because I wasn't sure if we were going to go there, but thank you for that. Okay, let's talk about business. Now, you've said building a business from scratch brings huge rewards, but there are sacrifices too. And I'm not going to soft soap what they are. What are they?
I think that basically my whole, starting my business took away my whole life. And still does to this day. I've watched people as we were driving here today, sitting outside, friends meeting for lunch, having a coffee at lunchtime. You know, I'm unable to do that because every hour of every day is mapped out for me, either in meetings or media work I'm doing, but mostly in business. So, somebody once said to me, you'll know when you've succeeded because you will then be able to say, I will if I want to. And I still can't say, I will if I want to.
You can't or you won't?
No, I can't, because I'm a very responsible soul. and I've got a great sense of responsibility to my employees, to people, because, you know, really, yes, I started the business, I wrote the script, I established the ethos and persuaded my people to engender the ethos of the company. But, you know, that business is now them. No business that is successful is one person, it's everybody.
You went to the bank and asked for a loan and was turned down, but you were absolutely determined that you were going to start your business.
Yes, I did.
So you sold your house.
My house.
You sold your car. You sold some jewellery.
Yeah.
And accumulated £112,000 to get things going.
Yeah, I borrowed about £30,000 at the end that I paid very dearly for. I paid about tenfold. That was because there was a delay in starting owing to British Telecom, which I never got any money back from them for. basically I had nothing, absolutely nothing. All I had in those days was either two or three outfits, and these outfits was kind of washed alternative days, ironed and worn the next day, because I was determined to look smart. I've always dressed as smart as my pocket could afford. I had very little, very, very little.
And you lived for a time on top of a
fish and chip shop. Yeah.
And am I right in believing that when the deep fat fryers turned off, your heating in the flat did as well?
Well, not quite, because the flat didn't have heating, but we did get warmth from the chip shop underneath. So when the chip shop closed, it went very cold.
My goodness. But great stories to tell of the sacrifices.
And I look back
made.
And it's really funny now, you know. And it was so, so cold in that place that the windows used to ice up inside. So I used to put tinfoil on the windows. And then I'd look at my child lying in bed.
Put tinfoil on him.
And then I'd wrap him in tinfoil as well. So it's kind of like when you look at your child, of, I think he was probably six at the time, you know, trussed up in bed like an oven-ready turkey. You then start to think, well, either I am what that bank manager said, I'm mad, or else I'm seriously determined I'm going to succeed.
And you were determined, and it was November.
Failure was not an option.
Okay, and I don't get the impression that's even part of your vocabulary.
No.
No. November?
29th, 1996.
Palace.
We opened for business.
Opened. Yeah. Porter cabin loos, I hear.
Two porter cabin loos, the chemical loos they were.
Right.
And they stunk. Absolutely stunk. Because if you can imagine, you know, I shared them with forklift drivers and about 50 lorry drivers that came in every night. So I learned excellent bladder control.
Right, okay.
No running water. So everybody that came to visit me, I used to plead with them to please bring me a bottle of tap water with you so I can make you a cup of tea.
Yeah. And now we're turning over.
Well, the business is now turning over over 100 million, possibly more, because we're now in Europe as well.
Right.
And on a rapid expansion plan.
But all this success and all this money and all this business has come with
nothing.
Some fairly hard lessons, hasn't it?
And nothing's for nothing in life. You know, anybody says you can have it all, I certainly have not had it all.
No. And there's a key to trying to find the balance, isn't there, between yourself as a lady, a mother and a businesswoman.
And I've not found that.
And you've not found it. Okay. Can you tell us about the relationship that nearly got the better of you?
To be perfectly frank with you, the first relationship that I had after my marriage to Malcolm, which wasn't troublesome at all. I mean, you know, we met very young, and basically I think at that age you either grow up together or you grow apart. And I'm very thankful that Malcolm met a lovely lady that he's still with today, 20 odd years later. So, you know, I'm glad he's found happiness. But my relationship, I was then on my own for a good 10 years before I met my son's father.
Hussein.
Yes. And that was, basically he was the whole relationship was a sham because it was lies. And it left me kind of virtually, well, I did have a physical and nervous breakdown. Okay. Although, because of my child, because there was only me putting food on the table, I had to work through it.
Mm. And Hussein was a drug street seller.
Well, no, whilst I was with him,
yeah.
I would have, I mean, I really, you've got to understand that, you know, he was Turkish. When he understood I learned Turkish, he'd then speak Greek, because he was a Turkish Cypriot.
Okay.
So when he began to realise that I could understand exactly what he was saying, he'd then speak Greek.
Okay.
And he kind of, I was in my world, which consisted of my child, my mum, my stepdad at that time, and very cosseted because I went to work, my mum had my son, pick him up, saw my mum every day, took my son back home, got him bathed, got him into bed. Hussein didn't come back till probably 9 at night. He had a factory, he was a CMT clothing manufacturer. Right. And as far as I knew, that's what he was doing in the days I was with him. It was many, many, many years later that I found out that he had been arrested for drug dealing.
Okay.
Whether he was doing that, I don't think he was, to be honest. But then again, I didn't know he was married and I didn't know he was living a double life, so who knows?
And you're still smiling, aren't you?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Can we talk about Mevlüt?
Yeah, Mevlüt's wonderful at the moment. He's been through hell and back. Addiction's not a nice thing, it's an illness.
You do a very candid piece of writing in the book about an evening when Mevlüt was begging you for money and he just would not stop. Mm. And you write it, I'm assuming, as you remember the conversation between you and him.
I remember it even today.
Yeah. You know, profanity, words and all, the whole thing.
Yeah.
How he spoke to you, how he spoke about you. It's almost as if the aggression jumps out on the page.
Yeah.
You refuse to give him money.
Yes.
You get in your car and drive off.
Yeah.
And I'm reading in between those lines, I've got to work, but my child needs me.
Yeah.
And there's almost like a bit of a struggle, bit of a pull.
Yes.
You know, working mums, if they have to work, they cannot be full-time mums. It's as simple as that. You start to drive off.
I was going to London.
Yeah.
And I got to Watford Gap, and at this particular time I was living in Leicester. So I'd only gone 2 junctions down the motorway.
Right.
Because
when I read Watford Gap, it's not Watford as such. We're talking Watford Gap, the Leicester, at the further up the M1.
Yeah. Junction 19.
Right, okay, thank you.
The phone had never stopped ringing, and I pulled into the Watford Gap services and I listened to his voicemails and I saw how many times he'd rang. And it was kind of like being struck by lightning. I thought, there's something wrong, I've got to go back. So I turned the car around and I headed back north up the motorway. As I drove up the driveway, I saw him hunched over in the conservatory as though he was in pain. And he walked out from the conservatory. And I still don't know to this day what made me say it, or I don't know. And straight out of my mouth come, it's drugs, isn't it?
And he says yes.
He said yes. And I said, get in the car. And he got in the passenger seat. And I said, is it heroin? And he said yes. I kind of like breathed a sigh of relief because he treated me so badly over the previous 2 or 3 years. I thought, this isn't my child. And of course it wasn't my child. His body was being ruled by
a drug,
and I, in some respects, I then gave him the money he needed because I knew he would steal it or mug somebody. You know, a heroin addict will find heroin in the Sahara Desert
because they're not really themselves, are they? You know, at that time when addiction was gripping him, he was not Mevlüt, your son,
no.
Was he?
No.
He was It was the remote control of heroin that was actually pressing his buttons and changing his channels.
And I kind of drove away a bit relieved. I gave him the money for his drugs. I then kind of got into London and did the meetings I had to do the next day. And I spent then another 2 days phoning every possible person I could find to give me information about drugs and heroin addiction. And eventually I found a rehab place in Luton. And I phoned them up, and basically it was, because there is no real help out there, and it is the only rehabilitation or medical institution that is still today not regulised by the health authority. And it was a question of, yes, your son's so old, yes, fine, he's a heroin addict, have you got your credit card available, we can take him next Wednesday.
Oh, right, nice.
And of course they did, and I thought, done, dusted, he'll come back, my little boy. Or big boy, as he was then. Mm. Of course it wasn't. It was just the start of a very, very long, tortuous journey.
It's the next chapter, isn't it? Because he's in. Mm. The next chapter is getting him out.
Yeah.
And then once he's out, it's about keeping him out.
Yeah.
And showing him a road that he will hopefully see as much sunnier than the road he's left behind him.
I think the coup de grace came because he'd moved out from home. How did you feel about that?
Knowing when he had come out of rehab the first time and he wasn't living at home, not being able to see him, watch him, I say control him in the motherly sense. How did that feel? How did you feel about that?
I did. I saw him every day.
Right.
It's just that I had nothing left in the house for him left to steal anymore. So he was in a hotel. Because at this stage I was still deciding on the best course of action for him, and somebody put him on a methadone treatment, which obviously is totally the wrong thing to do with heroin addicts. And I was still researching to find out the best way to cure him.
Whilst running your business?
Well, not only that, I'd gone through a marriage breakup as well during this time. So it was a pretty dark journey I travelled.
I can understand when you say writing this book wasn't therapeutic, because you'd obviously have to go back and really relive
the
some experiences that obviously caused you a lot of pain. So do you think that a heroin addict can truly kick the habit?
Well, my son has. Truly.
You say he's completely clean?
Yes.
You don't?
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
So forward.
Well, I made him, because he did relapse, I had him detoxed under comatose in a clinic in Harrogate called Detox 5, who I take my hat off to because they do a marvellous job. But he had a relapse and he was taking naltrexone tablets, which is an opiate blocker. And of course he stopped taking the tablets and had a relapse. So the next time I took him there, because it's a lot of money, and the next time I took him there, I told them to be particularly unkind with him and give him a rough time and make sure he didn't want to come back there. And I insisted that he had a naltrexone implant embedded very deep into his stomach so he couldn't cut it out, because a lot of heroin addicts will. And he had that replanted every 6 months for almost 2 years. And that was the end of it.
He's off.
Yes. He's now working. He's been working now for possibly 2.5-3 months, which may sound nothing to you, but it's 30 years ahead of where we were
right
5 years ago.
Okay, I hear that, and I get that one 100%.
Yeah, he goes to the pub at lunchtime with his girlfriend at weekend. They sit outside and have a shandy, because strange enough, he's never drank.
Right.
You know, he took every conceivable drug you can imagine and never drank alcohol.
Did you ever wonder how or where the drug addiction came from?
I think it came from the fact that, I think Mevlet always thought there was something missing in his life, because his father literally vanished when he was probably 3, 4, and he never had a birthday card, he never had a Christmas card. He never had any contact whatsoever, because obviously his father had found somebody else and started another family and another double life. And I think he always thought there was something missing. Plus, I think his granddad died when he was at a very vulnerable age of 12, and he was very, very close to his granddad. And I think he then felt very lonely and very isolated.
You know, even though I'm talking to you as a businesswoman, the mother is just flowering out here. Do you know what I mean? Should we get back to business?
Yeah.
Let's get back to business. Palex, multi-million pound company, not just in the UK now, branching out. How do you stay ahead of your competitors?
By being better. By innovating. By excelling. By being honest, by having integrity. You will never find Palex, even if we're able to, overcharging a customer, because if we actually feel that we are making too much money, then we will go back to that customer and say, you are paying us too much. Because we know full well that the competitor will go in and slash it anyway, and then it would damage denigrate my brand and denigrate my integrity. So better always to be honest in business. There's got to be winners on both sides of every business transaction.
Yeah, and you're obviously keeping your costs realistic.
It's tough lean times at the moment. It's a very challenging economic environment that we're trading in. And at the same time, we're still trying to expand, so into different countries throughout Europe. So, you know, yes, we have to be lean and mean, but also efficient.
I love it. And why a haulage business of all things?
Do you know, I don't know. I mean, I started working in a haulage company, James Booth's in Bolton.
Okay.
Which was a little haulage company. And when I was, 15, something like that. And God knows how it stayed with me forever, but I wouldn't even say that James Booth set me on the track to haulage. I was actually doing direct sales at the time and read an advert for somebody to work in the rag trade and deal with clothing manufacturers. So I thought I was going into fashion. And when I went for my interview, it was with a company called Tibbet & Britain, who did all the hanging garments, transported and carried out all the logistics and supply chain for people like Marks and Spencer's, French Connection, Jaeger, etc., etc. So by default, I ended up in logistics, but thought I was actually going into the fashion industry. And once you're in it, you can't get out of it. Such an incestuous industry.
Speaking of fashion, you're always so well turned out. Every hair in place, every shirt, every jacket, everything's always looking so polished. Who's your favourite fashion designer?
Myself, I think, at
okay.
the moment. But Alexander McQueen is a talent, I think, very rarely seen. And I think it was so very sad.
Very sad indeed. What's the most you've ever spent on an item of clothing, Hilary?
An Alexander McQueen dress that okay. I bought the day before he died. And I've not worn it yet. The label's still on it. And one day, I'll never wear it now, but one day I will donate it for a very good cause for charity.
Yeah. You have a love for Princess Anne.
Yes,
don't
I
you?
Do. I love her. I love our royal family, actually. I love them all. And I think that, you know, our country would be very sad without them. And I watched a documentary, actually, on the royals last night, and I was it was all about our Queen, Her Majesty, and going back through the years, and it was showing a scene from the decommissioning of the Queen Elizabeth, and she was almost in tears, and I thought, you know, wasn't this spiteful? Because she's absolutely committed to her country, to her people, and I thought, she deserved that. Mm. That's the least our country could have done for her. Mm. You know, and as for her Princess Royal, Princess Anne, she has a work ethos very, very similar to my own. I've seen the hard work she does for charity. I've seen her so very tired and yet always so immaculate.
You arranged a charitable ball that she turned up at?
I arranged a dinner for the Princess Royal Trust for Carers at my home in Rangemoore.
Yeah.
Which Princess Anne hosted for me.
Lovely.
But, you know, Prince William, Duchess of Kent, Duchess of Cambridge, Duke and Duchess of Kent, you know, they're all wonderful and they all give so much to our people and our country. And I think sometimes people don't reflect enough on what they do give and what they have sacrificed.
Mm. Well, you've answered that question. I was going to say, what's your stand on royalty, but thanks for that. Now, I need to know, what are the other dragons like? Now, come on, you're sitting on this panel now, and I have to say, I wonder, do you say no because you have to, or do you really think through your mind a lot of the time, is this a viable product? Is this going to work? Is it because we're in lean times? Is this just not a good business? What drives you with your decision making?
Absolutely. It is totally, utterly, 100% commercial acumen. And we've all got our own skill set. So, for instance, if somebody came on with an online product, I'd listen to what Peter had to say, because that's his field. If somebody comes on with a logistical product, they'll listen to what I've got to say, because that's my field. So is sales, so is marketing. But it is our money that we're investing. So I'm not going to put money into something where I'm not going to see a return, because that is not fair to Palex. And that is not fair to my employees at Palex.
Okay. I like that one. Saw you on Secret Millionaire with that lovely lady.
Sheila.
Oh my goodness.
Do you know we're still in touch? She texts me at least once, twice a week.
Took out that cheque for £62,000. She just did not know what to do with herself. That was just so, so lovely.
Yeah.
It really was. That must have given you a real sense
of... Oh God, it was fun. And we're still in touch today. Text me, in fact there's a text on my phone from her now. She texted me yesterday about going on Loose Women today. And you know, she gives me all the news on the site. We're also still in touch with the Backdoor Music Project, which is now a registered charity, and we got lottery funding for them. So, you know, that's going from strength to strength as well.
Great work. Now, the things that happen in your life shape you, and you've been definitely shaped into one incredible, successful woman. But it has been hard. Would you have liked your life to have been any different if you were to have a different past or a different path in life that would not have led you to Palex? Would you, if you could choose, would you have taken that path?
Do you know, that is such a difficult question, because I don't know, because it didn't.
Okay. And I can't ask for any more than that.
I think success has come at a price. It's come at a price with relationships. You know, I find that I'm married again in 2011, and literally within a month it was over, and I'm still actually grieving. And that actually broke my heart, literally broke my heart. And certain things that I found out subsequently. But, you know, you have to keep going and you pick yourself up. And the filming, the last series of Dragon's Den, was sheer hell, because I was going through this kind of breakup that he just didn't seem to care about. You know.
One of the questions that I hadn't planned to ask, and I hope you don't mind if I do you have to vet men that come into your life? You're a very wealthy woman.
Well, I wished I'd have vetted him more, and one day I will write about it, because, you know, I remember once saying to this particular gentleman, how have you got to this age in life, which he was slightly younger than me, he was 48, 49, because I've had a bloody good life and I've had a damn good time, I've enjoyed myself. And I thought, no, and I haven't. Mm. I've worked damn hard for every meal I've had put on the table. You know, I've worked for everything I've got in my life. Sometimes so exhausted and so tired, I'd cry out of exhaustion. And then people like him come along, and our laws are stupid, because they always go perceive the person with no money as the injured party and take it from the wealthy person. that has had to work damn hard for it. And that's the scenario I'm currently in at the moment.
Okay, but I'm sure you'll get through
that. I will get through.
Because you are bold as brass.
Yes.
Bold as brass. Hilary Devay. I think there's some unfinished business in this book. I think you're going to have to write a part two, aren't you?
Definitely. It's unfinished work.
Yeah.
And I never leave a job unfinished.
Oh, you heard the woman. She never leaves a job unfinished. Hilary, it's been a pleasure.
Mine too.
And very enlightening talking to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.